Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalam ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa alihi wa ba'd. Hello and welcome back to IHRC Bookshop. My name is Talha Asan, the host of the Abbasid History Podcast, which is generously sponsored by IHRC Bookshop. I'm particularly excited to be here today, joined by Dr. Mukhtar Ali, author of this book, Philosophical Sufism, An Introduction to the School of Ibn al-Arabi. It came at a very important time in my own thinking, and this is the first time actually meeting Dr. Ali like this. So let me give an introduction to our guest for this evening. Dr. Mukhtar Ali is a scholar of Islamic studies, specializing in Sufism, Islamic philosophy and ethics. His area of interest include Arabic and Persian literature, Quranic studies, theology and comparative religion. He is the author of this book here, Philosophical Sufism, An Introduction to the School of Ibn al-Arabi, published by Routledge in 2021, and Horizons of Being, which is that book, I think, The Metaphysics of Ibn al-Arabi in the Muqaddima of Al-Qaisari, which is published by Brill in 2020. And his forthcoming work is an annotated translation of Al-Jami's Naqd al-Nusus fi Sharh Naqsh al-Fusus, selected text commenting on the engravings of the Fusus. He has also translated works in classical and contemporary Islamic metaphysics, which include The Law of Correspondence in 2021 and The New Creation in 2018. While his teaching includes Islamic studies and Arabic language, he's also a practitioner of traditional Chinese medicine, that I didn't know, having earned a master's from the Emperor's College of Traditional Oriental Medicine 2011 and doctorate from Pacific College of Oriental Medicine. He's a graduate of Berkeley, and this is where also he did his PhD, and he's currently teaching at Illinois.
Yeah, University of Illinois.
And he's now passing through Wembley, or?
I live here.
You live here?
But I've recently moved over to the States.
Okay, cool. Yeah. Before we begin, we are going to ask Dr. Ali to read a selection from his book, please.
Assalamu alaikum, and thank you very much for having me. Yes. So I'm going to read a section from the first chapter, which is called Ontology. The timeless question of existence forms the basis of every other inquiry. What is the nature of being, and how do we come to know it? The starting point is to study being itself before investigating the existence of God, his attributes, creation, the human being, the macrocosm and the microcosm, and so on. We must first ask what being is in and of itself and why it is necessary to examine it. Let us begin by answering the second question first. Pondering the nature of being is not only the work of philosophers and metaphysicians, but intrinsic to every human being. At one time or another, we all wish to know the meaning of existence and our place within it. One might ask, how did I come to be? And where am I going? What is the purpose of life? And is there something beyond it? These are all existential questions that we ask ourselves, consciously or not. The questions, as well as the answers, are already within us and come to light in moments of reflection or inspiration. The quest to know reality is built into the very fabric of our consciousness. It underlies our humanness and separates us from the animals. Understanding the nature of being will also help us understand specific existence, such as language or music or love and justice, or any other material or abstract reality. But knowledge of general being is prior and more valuable than the knowledge of specific existence. As the late philosopher Jalal ad-Din Ashtiani explains, the nobility and value of any discipline is in proportion to its comprehensiveness. Any discipline that sets the foundation and principles of another is considered more valuable and nobler. Since the subject of the lesser discipline is based on the principles and arguments set forth in the higher, that is why philosophy, which discusses the very nature of existence, is considered a nobler discipline than mathematics, which discusses quantities, which are essential accidents of existence. Similarly, the science of music is considered dependent and subsidiary to the science of mathematics. This type of classification of knowledge is foundational in both scholastic and spiritual traditions. Since the subject of being forms the basis of every other discipline, philosophical Sufism is grounded in an ontology that also encompasses the fundamental issues concerning divine unity, God's attributes, and his relation to the world. Because the ontology of mysticism is not clearly understood, Sufi doctrines are often misrepresented by people who fail to grasp complex ideas such as divine manifestation, unity within multiplicity, or the concept of attainment and annihilation. Indeed, without understanding the very nature of a being, it is not possible to probe into secondary matters, such as the existence of the soul and its perfection, God's immanence and transcendence, and eschatological matters. Philosophical Sufism also describes the manifestation of the divine names as it relates to the methodology and practices of wayfaring of the people of God. Thus, understanding God and his attributes is a prerequisite for understanding the method of wayfaring and its corollaries.
Thank you, Dr. Ali. Yeah. As I said, this is the first time we're meeting. We had some brief correspondence by email. Mm-hmm. I got in touch with you out of the blue saying I'd come across your book, which is a bootleg version, rather naughtily, right? But I really wanted to read it, and so I got it printed out. And I don't know if people can see, but like it's full of like annotations and highlighting and like poetry in the margins that's inspired by the writing. And let me explain to you why I was so excited about this book and why I'm excited to meet you. So this felt like a godsend in a development of my own kind of intellectual journey. I won't bore you with all the details, but one book that had an impact upon me before reading this was a work by Peter Kraves, the theologian, the Catholic theologian based in Boston, his book, work Socratic Logic. Mm-hmm. So I read that because I wanted to sort of have some kind of mental hygiene, for want of a better phrase, right? I saw the chaos and discourse around us, and I thought this might be a worthy investment of my time. But through reading that, I came across this idea of how like the chaos of our times can almost sort of result from what's called enlightenment, but what others would perhaps call indarkenment, right? Mm. And particularly Kantian epistemology and his anti-realism, right? And how he's saying that we can never know reality with a capital R, we only can know our ideas about reality. Because once you say that, everything goes like a slippery slope to the chaos we find in our contemporary culture. And then that sort of, the other point that Kraves make, which I think resonates with what you just read there, he says, before you have politics, ethics, first you have ontology, then you have epistemology, then you have ethics. So there's like this building, right? So if, as Kant says, and I don't claim to be a philosopher, this was sort of read sort of tangentially in my spare time, if he claims you can never know capital, if he claims you can never know the real with a capital R, you can never know truth with a capital T, there is no ontology there, or there's some kind of fabricated ontology, and that has impact upon ethics and politics, exactly as you said, right there, and as well as aesthetics in terms of music and language, right? So sort of the ugliness we see around us. I think because I drove here from South London, we saw the ugliness of coming through Wembley and sort of these ugly buildings, right? So that's why this is pretty important to me, and why I'm so keen to have this discussion. And I'm sure you're going to touch on all of that as we talk for the next hour or so. Before we begin, why don't you just tell us about Ibn Arabi, this figure first, before we get to the meat of his intellectual legacy.
Okay. Now, Ibn Arabi was a great mystic, rather than a philosopher. He was a saint, a mystic, and in Arabic we call it Arif. There's a lot of study and work about Ibn Arabi. There's a resurgence of the study of his writings. Mm-hmm. So I don't want to go too much into it, but simply stated, he was a visionary mystic. Mm-hmm. And a very prolific writer, and a very expansive thinker. Mm-hmm. So he was able to document his visionary experiences. Most of what he wrote about were his visions. And what he did was he codified that. So it wasn't random visions. We all see visions and we have dreams and we have spiritual experiences. Everybody does.
Right.
The difference between a systematic thinker like Ibn Arabi is that he was able to collect all that material and create a framework, a system, a metaphysical system. And so that's what we have here. And so he was probably the most influential thinker of Islam after, say, you know, Al-Ghazali, or among the top, you know, five important thinkers. Mm-hmm. Because he shaped what he said could not be ignored. Whether you agreed with it or disagreed with it, it had an impact in the rest of Islamic history and in the world, and we feel that today.
Near the end, we'll get to sort of contentions about Ibn Arabi as a person
and his
ideas. But let's look at this book. So you divide it up in 12 parts. You start off with ontology, and it's almost like a very, I think it'd be fair to say, sort of layered. It's very careful how you set a foundation and you build up this cosmology. When you talk about ontology first, and you talk about its importance, how do we sort of move on from there up until we get to this idea of prophethood and sainthood? How from ontology do we then get our conceptions of the divine?
Okay, let me first explain the title.
Okay.
And hopefully that can, you know, unleash some of the ideas.
Okay.
So it's called philosophical Sufism because, first of all, it's actually Sufism. And Sufism is what? It's mysticism, Islamic mysticism. In the Arabic word is arfan. Mm-hmm. And not all of the urafa or the mystics affiliated themselves with the Sufis. The Sufis were a particular group, and they had a particular legacy. So not every arif is considered a Sufi.
Oh, interesting.
Okay, so there's a distinction. But because Western academia has already set the standards and the terminology, they tend to lump all of Islamic mysticism in this term Sufism. So it's not fair to say that everything that we do in mysticism is Sufism.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Any case, it's a term that's being used now, so I decided to use that.
Mm-hmm.
So Sufism is the mystical method, the interior path. Why is it philosophical? Most Sufis see that reality as ascertained and understood through unveiling, through spiritual experience, through what is known as mukashifa or mushahada, some of these spiritual methods. So where does philosophy come into this? Philosophical methodology has to do with deductive reasoning or the use of reason. So it's not an amalgamation of Sufi methodology and philosophical methodology. That's not what's being done here. It's not a syncretic methodology. What's happening here, and this is kind of an insight into the whole theory, the whole construct of the book, is that Ibn al-Arabi was able to articulate his visionary experience in a language which corresponded to philosophical terminology. That was one thing. The second thing, which is a bit a more subtle, a subtler point, is that the intellect is able to translate the vision and experience of the heart.
Mm.
That's what philosophical Sufism is.
Mm.
The intellect translating. Say you have an experience, you love someone. How are you going to translate that? You write them a poem. You perhaps cook them a meal. You do something nice for them. So you're translating something, an emotion, a feeling, a reality inside through action or words. So this idea, this school of philosophical Sufism, and again, I use the word school kind of loosely, is that it is using the aql, the intellect, an expressive voice to describe a cosmology. That's what's going on here.
Okay.
Yeah.
Before we get sort of an overview of this book, I just want to pick up two points you made there. Distinguishing between ma'rifah and tasawwuf, right?
Okay, yeah.
And what you just said here, which was sort of struck me as well, the arif
mm-hmm.
and the Sufi
yeah.
are two different things. I mean, I don't think I'm alone in saying that that's probably the first time I've heard that kind of distinction. Do you want to sort of help us with that?
Okay. First of all, this book is a commentary on this book.
Okay. Should we share the camera with that?
Okay. All right. So this is the first book that came out. And this is a translation, an annotated translation of Qaysari's introduction to Ibn al-Arabi's Fusus al-Hikam. Mm-hmm. It's called Muqaddama Qaysari. It's studied in Iran extensively in all of the seminaries and all of the major centers which focus on theoretical mysticism.
Okay.
Okay. Qaysari never once used the word Sufi, but he used the word Arif, Arfan, Ahl al-Haqiqah, the people of truth, the people of reality, the people of God, Ahl Allah. So these are all terms. And Sufi is one of the terms that's also used in Islamic culture to mm-hmm. describe these people.
Right.
But they're not. It's not every Arif is a Sufi and vice versa. There's some subtle distinctions, historical distinctions. Just to be aware of that.
Is that a Shia Sunni thing? Because Irfan is always like the Shia Sufism, and then is Sufism like
not,
a Sunni?
Not really. I mean, they themselves call themselves the Urafa, Ahl Allah, Arif.
Yeah.
You know, and Ibn al-Arabi wasn't a Shia. He was, you know, Sunni, and so was Qaysari, and many of the Urafa were Sunni, but they still themselves the Arifs, Urafa.
The other thing about this idea of unveiling as well, that sort of implies this idea that there is a reality of the capital R sort of beyond that, and there's sort of means to that. You have sort of empirical means to that, or you can have sort of like a rational means to that, but then there's also this sort of more intuitive grasp of this reality, and that's what this book is sort of systemizing.
So what the Arif is doing, or what the Arif desires, is the same thing that the philosopher desires. Mm-hmm. Everyone desires the same thing. We want to know about life. We want to know about reality.
Yeah.
What does this world mean? What is this all about?
Mm-hmm.
The Arif is the same. And there's no difference. The only difference is the Arif is going a step further, using, say, meditative practices, delving into spiritual practices to ascertain the truth. So the Arif is also trying to establish what is reality. We cannot deny that there is a reality. We can say we may not be able to know what reality is, but the Arif says, yes, we can know something of reality. We cannot know absolute reality because that's God. But we can know something of reality. We can arrive at haqiqah. And so the whole first chapter ontology discusses and describes haq and haqiqah. Haqiqah is reality. Haq is the truth. Or it can refer to God, being. And so these are interchangeable words in this discourse, in the discourse of mysticism and arfan, even in philosophy.
So the book is divided in 12 parts: ontology, divine names, attributes, divine knowledge, origin of multiplicity, universal worlds, imaginal world, unveiling, human vice agency, existential circle, supreme spirit to the microcosm, prophethood and sainthood, and resurrection. Now, once you've covered ontology, and in that you talk about sort of universal degrees and sort of very sort of subtle things like that,
mm-hmm.
How does then this sort of map onto, or how does this follow onto how we understand sort of the divine names and attributes? Because that's always been a sort of a sort of contentious debate. It's also plagued some Muslim sects.
Okay, so the rationale for the chapters, it goes like this. It goes from the most general. Wujud, absolute being,
right,
which is the most general concept. And then it discusses first the divine planes and then the human planes.
Right.
So it's a distillation from the absolute to the specific. And the first is wujud mutlaq, absolute being. The first absolute being is the unknowable essence. So what can we talk about the unknowable essence? We talk about immanence and transcendence and those... at those theological topics. What is the nature of divinity? What is God? What is God? What is existence? So now, the Arif, or even in Islamic theology, we say that God is, from one perspective, the unknowable, the absolute. Laysa kmithlihi shay. There's nothing like him, so you cannot know him. But at the same time, the Quran says he is where wherever you face, there is the face of God. Wherever you turn, there's the face of God, or he's closer to you than your jugular vein, and so on. So God is imminent, he's there. And so from that vantage point, then we get into this whole idea of the divine names. Now the divine names is the, I would say, the jewel of the Islamic methodology. No one has spoken, no religion has spoken about the divine names as Islam has spoken about it.
Right.
This is the essence of the Quran. Besides Tawheed, Tawheed is what? Is absolute oneness, but then that oneness becomes differentiated into the first plane of reality, which is the divine names. So the divine names are the first perfections that come out of the divine essence. Okay, so this is also the plane of divinity. And no one has spoken about the divine names as Islam has spoken about it. This is the essence of Islam. So then we go to the divine names, and then we talk about, from the divine names, we talk about the aspects of divine knowledge. And so what is it after that?
After that is origin of multiplicity.
Yeah, which is the divine names. But not technically, multiplicity originates with the first creation. Although the divine names is a sort of multiplicity. It's a conceptual thing. How is God one at the same time multiple? This is an important theological concept. How is he one? We say God is one. La ilaha illallah. God is, you know, there's one God. Right. This is the motto of Islam, monotheism. So then where does multiplicity come from? How do we account for all of this? How do we account for the divine names? So on. So that's a discussion on that topic.
And that's where you go into this aspect of Jalal and Jamal, and then sort of like, sort of almost akin to like a light going through a prism, and it's how the divine manifests itself in the world and all that kind of stuff.
Right, so the key term to understand unity within multiplicity is the concept of manifestation, dhuhur and tajalli. That's the key term. If you understand the concept of dhuhur and tajalli, you can explain the concept of multiplicity arising from unity, from one. You can explain the Christian doctrine of the Trinity. The Christians say, oh, God is one, he's three and one, one and three. We also say the same thing. We don't say three, we say one and 99, 99 and one, right? The difference is that we say the essence is absolute. It's one. But God at the plane of manifestation is multiple. At the level of manifestation, he's multiple. But at the level of the essence, the haqiqah, the absolute reality of God is one.
I mean, I have to, one thing about reading your book, like I said, it's in the margin, I wrote all this sort of inspired poetic stuff, right? It's, and I mean this as a praise, right? It's quite a trip to read your book, right? it's like, just now, I was just sort of flicking through the chapter on multiplicity. And you know, there's like sentences there, because on the one hand it's really sort of conceptual, and at the same time it's sort of like, it's almost like sort of quantum mechanics. It's sort of describing something happening at such a sort of microcosm level of reality that it comes sort of paradoxical to understand. And I was wondering whether, as you was writing it, whether it's as much as a trip for the writer as it was as it is for a reader.
Absolutely. I mean, absolutely. Look, first of all, this is the right. This is. Let me explain something. I'm just a conduit to present ideas. Okay, the real author is the one who received these inspirations. Ibn al-Arabi and the Urafa, the people in his circle. Sadruddin Qunawi was a great scholar, was a great mystic, who was Ibn Arabi's student. And then Qaysidi was a great mystic. So this is a lineage, and this is a school of saints. It's not a school of thinkers and philosophers and scholars. They're saints. They receive the maqam that is, you know, really close to God. So God inspired them, endowed with real knowledge. Ilm ladunni, real knowledge, not things that we think and make up.
Right.
So that's what Ibn al-Arabi is talking about. So his knowledge is light. Just like the Prophet. The Prophet, why is the Quran valued in Islam? Why do we value the Quran? Because it's nur. Because it's light. It's God speaking to the heart of the Prophet Muhammad. And so that's what came out. It's the Quran. It's in words. But that those words are light. It's nur. So similarly, just as prophets receive revelation, the mystics also receive revelation. The mystic is the lesser prophet. And the prophet is another maqam, another station of the arif. The prophet is just an arif. He's a mystic. But he has a special rank of prophet, of nubuwwah. What does nubuwwah even mean? It means inba. It means to inform. So he has a duty to inform what he receives from God. And that's what the arif is doing. So this kalam is nur. And what I've done here is I've included the spiritual sentences and the hikmah and the wisdom of all of these thinkers, these followers of Ibn Arabi, who were also great scholars. So you'll see there's gems in it, and not because I have anything to do with it. It's just that it just came together like that. The people who are speaking in it, the Urafa, they're the ones who are speaking the words of light. So that's why. Even when I look at it, I'm like, wow, this is amazing. You know? And it has nothing to do with me. It's because it's when I look at Qunawi, what he says, look at this. Okay, Ibn al-Arabi alludes to the finer point. First of all, Ibn al-Arabi says, I just opened it up to a random page. Okay? I say that God's majesty is a meaning that relates to him to himself. Yeah. Jalal of Allah relates God to himself. And he has prevented us from knowing him through al-ma'rifa bihi, through this. Beauty is a meaning that relates to him to us. And it is that which gives us the knowledge that we have of him. With respect to the revelations, tanazzulat, visions, mushahadat, and states ahwal. So these are the people of mushahadat who are seeing visions, who are having states, who are having tanazzulat. God descends on their heart. The arif is one whom God speaks to. No one is considered an arif until God speaks to you, until one he receives from God directly. That's the arif. That's the mystic in Islam.
So
anyway, yeah.
You mentioned a couple of names of people, and I want to talk about Ibn Arabi's students and their students, and sort of get that sort of genealogy of written words. Before we do that, let's carry on sort of going through these chapters and sort of get a sort of summary of the chapters. Another thing is, it's true, Richie, you can literally open up this page and you just like read these sentences. Like even here, here's something I highlighted from chapter 6. Although it is a single reality, when authors refer to its macrocosmic aspect, it is called a disconnected imaginal world, al-alam al-mithal al-munfasil. And when they refer to the microcosm faculty of imagination in the human, it is called connected imaginal world, alam al-mithal al-muttasil. We'll get to that, this curve of composition cosmology. But I do want to say to anyone who's watching this, and when I said it's like trippier, it is also very lucid and coherent. It's like a structured build-up argument. And like with good poetry, it makes the unfamiliar familiar and the familiar unfamiliar. It does work very coherently up and sort of, it starts from this very basic level of what is reality, and it sort of builds up the structure. So we carry on. So after multiplicity, you talk about these worlds.
Okay.
And let's. What do you mean by these worlds?
Okay, this is good. So ontology is the structure of being, talking about being as in a general sense, and then explaining why. What happens when we have the divine names? We have the first level of multiplicity. But real multiplicity comes in when we talk about the origin of multiplicity. Okay? The Aql al-Awwal, the first intellect, and so on. Then we go into a discussion of the universal world, which is now we've established that multiplicity exists, and we've described how multiplicity originates from unity. Now we can talk about the five or six essential planes of existence. Mm-hmm. First is the divine plane. Then we have the world of let's say, according to the world of spirits, the spiritual realm, or we can say the world of intellect, the imaginal, the material, and one which is the comprehensive, which is insan. So there's like four or five different worlds.
Right.
Okay? The first world being the divine, meaning the divine names. Then the world of intellect, the imagination, the absolute imagination that we participate in.
Right.
So God created all things in a macrocosmic way, in a sort of a template. So there's the universal intellect, the universal imagination, the universal body, and so on. And then there's insan. So this whole second aspect, once we get to the universal, then we talk about the imaginal world. This is important. We talk about unveiling. Now we're getting into epistemology. Right. So the first five chapters deals with ontology. The next five or six chapters deal with epistemology.
Right.
Which and the last one is eschatology.
Just for anyone listening who doesn't know what that means. Epistemology is sort of the study of how we know things.
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly. How we come to know things. So then we talk about unveiling. And this is a really important feature of Islam.
Right.
Not just mysticism, not just Sufism. I mean, the Quran is the Muhammadan unveiling.
Right.
Right? So the entirety of Islam, all of our beliefs in the Quran, in the Prophet Muhammad, are based on the Muhammadan vision. He went up to the cave, and he saw Jibreel, who came down. He gave him this revelation. That's the whole basis of Islam.
Right.
So no one can deny unveiling as an epistemological method.
Right.
How did the Prophet become a prophet? He saw it in a vision.
Right.
How did Musa receive this or that? Or how did Isa speak to God? And that's unveiling. So unveiling is an established methodology. It's not something that's only reserved for the Sufis and the Arif or the mystic or the occult. It's not occult. It's the root of the Quran, of Islam.
Right.
The root of every religion is unveiling.
I mean, perhaps other words we can call it sort of intuition of like the truth.
It's
like sometimes I think even people who are watching this, like anyone from a Muslim background, through moments of like heightened spirituality, like maybe during Ramadan they're fasting, they're praying, right? Things come to their minds, like sort of pithy sort of aphorisms come to their mind from nowhere, and then they'll read a book by a Muslim scholar from a different time, and they'll see almost like word by word that thing. And I guess where it gets so problematic is then how do you know what is intuition from God and what's intuition from the devil? And I guess that's what this is sort of the science of.
Yeah, exactly. It gives you a structure, a rubric. It gives you principles of thought. But then again, you know, there's different levels. There's inspiration, there's intuition, there's even a type of guessing, hats, it's like intuition,
right.
Clairvoyance, and then the highest level is revelation,
right?
Which is what the prophets receive. But it's all one thing on a spectrum of intensity. So that's what we get into in the next chapter. So we have to set up the imaginal world, talk about that. It's a very important facet because it deals with dreams, dream interpretation, which is an established science in the Quran. Yusuf alayhi salam was the prophet of dreams. He used to interpret dreams. So this is established in the Quran. Mm. And again, like these things are lost in our community, in our culture.
Precisely, right, yeah.
And these are established realities, established truths in the Quran. This is not just reserved for only Yusuf.
Right.
And Mubashirat, you know, the dreams are 1/40 of prophecy.
Right.
According to a prophetic hadith. So that is discussed in the imaginal world. Of course, unveiling is a more detailed discussion of how we know beyond the deductive mind, intuition, unveiling, mushahada, and so on.
Right.
Then we get into some other very typical concepts in Ibn Arabi's cosmology, where he talks about the human vicegerency. But again, this is not something outside of the Quran, right? The Quran speaks about إِنِّي جَعْلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. God says, I'm going to place on the earth a representative, a khalifa, a vicegerent. So here, this is what it is. The human vicegerent. What makes insan khalifatullah? Who is the khalifa? And so that discussion is there. And we're looking now into spiritual anthropology. The human vicegerency is spiritual anthropology.
That's a wonderful term, spiritual anthropology.
Yeah. And it deals with what is the origin of man?
Right.
What is the human being? Without knowing this, how can a person, how can any human being fulfill their reality, their humanity, live a full life? Everybody wants to live a full life, let's face it, right? Everybody wants to maximize and live the fullest life possible. Whether you see that in wealth, whether you see that in doing human rights work, whether you see that doing art, being a musician or an artist, whatever it is, you want to live the fullest life possible. And so the spiritual-minded individual takes into consideration the ruh, the spirit. So they see that the human reality is the spirit. What is the spirit and how do I perfect the spirit? And so on. That's that. And then again, now the existential circle, that deals with this whole idea of a movement. That man begins as a spirit from God, comes into this earth, that's one half of the circle, and now has to make a journey back to God. And so the circle is complete. It's an existential circle. Mm.
By the way, if you ever do a second print of the book, you really should have diagrams, because later, you know, when you start setting up the whole like cosmology, it would be really good if there was like a...
That's true.
Nice diagram.
Yeah, that is true. I think William Chittick in his Sufi Path of Knowledge has some good diagrams.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, so take a look at that. But yeah, so that's the existential circle. And then, the supreme spirit in the microcosm. First of all, this term microcosm and macrocosm. There's this idea in not only in ancient times, in ancient Greek and Hermetic philosophy, Indian philosophy, and all philosophies, Chinese as well as Islamic philosophy, that as above, so below. Whatever you see in the world above is contained within you. As Imam Ali says, أَتَزْعَمُ أَنَّكَ جُرْمٌ سَغِيرٌ وَفِيكَنْ طَوَى عَالَمٌ أَكْبَرٌ. Do you think, do you suppose that you are a small particle, but within you is the entire universe? So he's saying that everything that God has created in macro as a universal is contained within you in essence. And that's another reason why the insan is Khalifatullah, because the Khalifa is one who represents divinity. As we have in the hadith that God said that I have created man in my image. خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانِ فِي سُورَتِهِ. This is a hadith in Bukhari and the Sunni and Shia sources. Of course, it's also in the Bible. So, in Abrahamic religions, man has been created in the image of God. An image not in the physical form of God. God does not have a form, but in the haqiqah, in the reality of God. The reality of God is what? Divine names. That's why it goes back to the divine names, and we have to set up the divine names as the foundation of Islam. So, all of this goes back to the divine names. And the man is the Khalifa because he possesses the divine names. وَعَلَّمَ آدَمْ الْأَسْمَى كُلَّهَا. As it says in the Quran, we have taught Adam all of the names.
Right.
Yeah. So, go ahead.
And so so then you've got the final chapters on prophethood and sainthood and resurrection. So how does that all tie up with?
So now prophethood and sainthood are talking about the insan al-kamil. This represents, when we talked about the human vicegerency in a general sense, now specifically the perfect human is the prophet. And what I mean by perfect, or what Ibn Arabi and what the scholars mean by perfect, is not absolute perfection. It means the complete human. The one who has realized his humanity, or her humanity, in the case of Asiya and Fatima and so on, and some of the women. So they are also insan al-kamil. Anyone who realizes their true purpose in existence, maxes their wujud, their existence, becomes perfected. And so the Prophet is an example of that. And sainthood is the inward aspect of prophethood, because there's no prophethood without sainthood.
Right.
The Prophet is first a saint, then a prophet.
Right.
So sainthood is a chain that continues. And this is where Sufism of Ibn al-Arabi and all the Sufis and Shi'ism coalesce and combine. Because we, in the Shi methodology, have a very strong sense of wilaya. And so this is the shared common ground between Sufism, actually Shi'ism and Sunnism, because a lot of the Urafa, the Sufis, were Sunni.
Right.
And so on the topic of wilaya, this is where we come in and we really have, you know, this idea of the imperfect human, the chain of wilaya, and so on.
Right.
So this is an important point.
And then finally,
yeah,
you talk about resurrection.
Right. Now, resurrection is not in the standard sense, because the way Ibn al-Arabi and Qaisari talk about resurrection is from a philosophical, ontological perspective. Right. It is the return of things to their origin. It is the inversion of reality. It is the governance of some names over others. So these are different terms. It's not simply that, oh, we die, we're going to go into paradise or hell, and we're going to cross the bridge. This is standard theology. He's looking at things, the Arif is looking at matters from a philosophical perspective. How do we explain resurrection? How do we answer this question? How is it that in God's justice, that God would punish a person eternally for certain acts they have done temporally? So they killed a person unjustly. That was one act in one moment in time. Why would that person be punished eternally in hell? Right? And for example, we can talk about this same concept in Muharram, right? Yazid, who killed Hussein, why would he be punished eternally for one act that he did temporally? It's a philosophical question. Something to think about. We won't go into that right now. Because it requires a lot of, you know...
Unpacking.
Unpacking, exactly.
I mean, I think... Okay, let's... So, we've given an overview of the book. And you mentioned some names, and I think it's important to look at sort of the intellectual genealogy.
Mm-hmm.
So, you obviously have Ibn al-Arabi, you mentioned al-Qunawi, then we have al-Jandi, Kashani, Qaisari. So when you tell us who these people are, and so the different texts, so obviously we've got Ibn al-Arabi's main works, and then we've got his commentaries and super commentaries and summaries and stuff. Why don't you give us sort of like an overview of that for us as well?
Sure. That's a good question, because when we study Ibn al-Arabi, we're actually studying two things. We're studying Ibn al-Arabi himself and his works, and we're studying the way in which his works were received by his students and others. In other words, the commentarial tradition surrounding his works. So there's Ibn al-Arabi and his thought. And when you actually read Ibn al-Arabi, a lot of it is so convoluted, it's so recondite that it's difficult to put your head around. Because why? Because he's writing his visions. It's like if you were to sit down and write your dream, right, only you would understand it. If you give it to someone else, it's a stream of consciousness. It's a vision. So not everything that Ibn al-Arabi writes is necessary for your consumption and my consumption. And this is the same thing with the Quran. Not everything in the Quran is for our consumption. There are things which are specific to the Prophet. There are certain verses that are specific to certain individuals and not others. This is a major issue with respect to understanding and absorbing the Quran. Yes, the Quran is an absolute thing which came to the template of Muhammad. So the whole of the Quran corresponds to the whole of Muhammad. But the whole of the Quran does not correspond to me, to the whole of me. I'm only a part. I can only grasp a bit of it, some of it, as much as my qabiliya, my ability allows. So for example, alif, lam, mim. Who knows what that means? Hamim. Who knows what that means? It's not for you and me. There's a mystical words, letters. It's for the Ahl, the people who God reveals that to. Maybe Muhammad, maybe some saint. So it's not for everyone. Similarly, there's verses in the Quran, some stories you're like, what is this all about? Why is God mentioning the cow of the Bani Israel and this long story of Ad and Thamud and these people? What is that? How is that relevant to me? This is a very important, relevant question when we look at the works of not just Ibn Arabi mysticism, but also the Bible and the Quran.
Right.
It's a practical thing. That not all of it is for you. So similarly, some of the teachings were of Ibn Arabi were given to his student Qunawi.
Right.
But Qunawi had his own disposition. He was a philosopher. He was a trained philosopher. He was a systematic thinker.
Right.
But he didn't grasp everything Ibn Arabi said. Nobody could grasp everything that he said, just like nobody could grasp everything that the Prophet Muhammad said. Nobody, not even the Imams. They all had, and that's why Imam Ali says, I am a servant, an abd of Muhammad. I'm a servant, a slave of Muhammad. As great as Imam Ali was, he was just a servant of Muhammad. So think about, put that in the context. And this khilafah, this absolute reality, the first thing that God created, according to the hadith in the Sunni and Shia books, the first thing that God created was the Nur al-Muhammadi. Haqiqa Muhammadiyya. So Muhammad is the absolute reality. His reality is absolute. No one can reach that. Not even Jibreel, not even Ali, not nobody. So just like we have that paradigm in the prophetic tradition, we also have it in other traditions as wilaya carries on. So no one can grasp everything Ibn Arabi said. So when we read Qunawi, we're reading part of Ibn Arabi. When we listen to the hadith of the imams, for example, Imam Ali, Imam Hussein, so on, we're reading a part of what Muhammad was. And so that's something to take into consideration. And some excelled over others. Some, according to their individual qabiliyya, their capacity, their closeness. Qunawi was a great scholar.
He was a stepson,
and also a very, you know, his closest student.
Right. And so the other figures, why don't you give us a brief gloss of...
So there's Jandi was a student of Qunawi, who was also an arif.
Right.
Then there's Kashani, Abdul Razak Kashani was a great scholar who did a lot for the school. He wrote commentaries and a commentary on Ibn Fusus al-Hikam. He wrote a commentary on Manazil al-Sa'irin, which is very interesting because when you think of philosophical Sufism, you have to put this into context of practical mysticism.
Right.
Actually reaching God. Actually reaching perfection. It's not a theoretical discipline. It's not, when you talk about Irfan Nazari in the Islamic tradition, theoretical Irfan, it's not just Irfan for its own sake. It's not philosophizing. It's a cosmology that helps you to understand yourself. That's the whole point of this. That's why the Prophet says, Man arafa nafsah, faqad arafa rabbah. He who came to know himself came to know his Lord. So the purpose of all of this is to know yourself. It's not to philosophize for the sake of philosophy.
Right.
To write a dissertation, a thesis, and get a job somewhere.
Right.
It is to know yourself. It's to reach perfection. It's to have adab ma'allah. It's to build your akhlaq. So the theory has to be put in the context of the practice. And that's why Kashani, Tilmisani, and among others, wrote commentaries on Ansari, Abdullah Ansari's Manazil al-Sa'irin. Manazil al-Sa'irin is a whole discipline about wayfaring.
Right.
How does a person go from stage to stage, station to station, to reach God?
And it's been translated recently. Those who don't know, it's a work by Hanbali figure, and I actually want to come to you about Ibn Arabi and the Hanbali tradition maybe later. I don't know if Aishasi sells that. Do they sell that? Maybe. All right, okay. Sorry. So, and the other figures, in terms of this intellectual genealogy of Ibn al-Arabi?
Sure. So then we have Dawud al-Qaisari.
Right.
And as I said, this is Muqaddamat al-Qaisari. And the reason why I translated this book is because it's the first book that I studied in,
right,
in this discipline,
right,
with a teacher. And so, you know, that's the other important thing is that these works, you know, it's good to study with the teacher because there's subtleties that you get from
talaqqi and all that.
Yeah, exactly. Right. You know, talaqqi is you receive a spiritual transmission, and you may receive by Allah directly.
Okay. So just to be clear, so this book by Al-Qaisari is a summary of...
It's the introduction to his commentary of the Fusus al-Hikam. Fusus al-Hikam is Ibn al-Arabi's sort of most famous work.
Right.
And it's basically the essence of the 27 prophets.
Right.
Each one is considered to be like a gemstone in a ring.
Right.
So he talks about the essence of these prophets according to his vision. And so Qaisari wrote an introduction to Fusus, but in that introduction he wrote again all the principles, the necessary principles. So what I did was I wrote a commentary based on other commentaries,
right,
on that and put it together as this one here. All right. So then we have Qaisari, which was a major figure, and because his work was very clear, he was a very, very clear, and was an excellent scholar, and so his work has become very famous. But then, then it goes on, and you have Abdul Rahman Jami, who lived around the same time. He died in 1492. He lived around after, but before Jami, we have Sayyid Haydar Amli, which is a major figure in Shi'ism. Haydar Amli is celebrated in Iran, but he was very, very vehemently opposed to the legalism that was occupying Shi'i thought.
Right.
And he said that, and so Shi'ism for a long time, probably even today, has been very opposed to the mystical outlook, even though we have this in the teachings of the Imams.
Sounds a bit like Ghazali in the Sunni tradition.
Yes, right. Yes. So later Ghazali took a turn and he became, you know, very much a proponent of the Sufis.
Right.
So Haydar Amli, from the outset, was a Sufi Shia and he wanted to bring in the teachings of Ibn Arabi into mainstream Shi'ism.
Would he have been the first one to have done that?
I don't know if he's the first one, but I know he was, because he was such a prominent scholar,
right,
that he had a major impact,
okay,
into. And then, of course, Mullah Sadra was also part of that tradition in Safavid Iran, Sabzawadi, following Mullah Sadra. So Ibn al-Arabi's imprint is founded in Iran. As far as Abdurrahman Jami was one of those scholars who had an impact not only in Iran, because he was a Persian poet, but also in the Ottoman Empire, and his works were translated into Chinese.
Oh, wow, okay.
Yeah, so anyone who studies Islam in China, the first two works ever translated into Chinese from the Islamic tradition, according to Sachiko Murata, she claims that, were two works by Abdurrahman Jami.
Wow, okay.
So anyone who studies Islam in China is going to be in touch with Ibn al-Arabi's ideas.
Our hour's nearly up.
Yeah.
And if you're okay, I do want to continue because there's so much I want to talk about.
Sure, absolutely.
Obviously, there's contentions that some people watching this might have. Obviously, there's a lot of things you said which needs to be unpacked, and I don't think we can be able to sort of have the opportunity to do that. I'm particularly keen on... again, talking about, because you have a presentation on Abdullah Ansari's
Manazil
Sa'idi on the bit on Akhlaq, and I want to go into that as well.
Yes.
What are we going to do about time then? Are we okay carrying on, or do you want to take questions, or how do we want to do this? Because I might go on for another, like, well, we could go on a couple of hours, right? But I don't know if we're going to cut the live stream or how do you want to do this? Because these are really juicy things, by the way, that can unpack.
Go into the questions for the live stream in about 10 minutes or so, because people are sending questions.
People are sending in questions.
We'll check. And maybe carry on after the questions, perhaps, if the author's happy.
Are you happy then to carry on for...
Absolutely.
All right. So let's do this, because normally, before the hour ends, we ask you to sort of tell us about any your current works and projects.
Okay.
Then we'll invite the questions, and then I have questions anyway. I have tons of questions. Okay, so why don't you tell us about some... so you have this work, you've got that work, and why don't you tell us about any of your sort of current projects? You've got your YouTube channel, why don't you tell us about that?
Sure, I mean, the YouTube channel, it needs work, it needs, you know, constant attention. So right now, my focus is writing. I'm trying to finish up some writings.
Right.
One of them is a complete translation of Haydar Amali's Jami' al-Asrar, his most important famous work,
right.
Which it's really a beautiful work, and he brings a lot of important evidences from the Ahl al-Bayt, from the tradition of the Ahl al-Bayt, to support these claims that Ibn Arabi and others are making within this school. So that's really an important thing that we have to, you know, not everyone can read the Arabic.
Sure.
And I think, you know, now English has become sort of a universal language, so...
it's almost become the language of Islam, like Urdu.
Absolutely. Yeah, it has, you know. But what I'd like to do is this one here, this is a parallel Arabic-English translation.
Oh, that's really cool.
Yeah, so that's nice for learners who want to, you know, you can't get away from the original Arabic.
No.
You know, the translation is always going to be an approximation. So my advice to anyone who's studying this material is to try to struggle with the terminology and try to at least learn some of the basic terms. When we say wujud, let's take this word wujud, for example. Wujud means existence, being. But wajada in Arabic means to find, right? And, you know, William Chittick has talked about this a lot, that it's not just being, but it's also finding. Wujud is what you find and so on. Or alam. Alam comes from alima. The word alam, it means world. But alam, alima, is to know. So alam, the world, is that which is known. You come to know. So there's a relationship in the Arabic, and this is the beauty of the Arabic language, and one of the reasons why when you delve into the Quran and you delve into the linguistic aspect, you find it unpacks and it unfolds all these different meanings from the linguistic perspective when you combine the language and the meaning. So similarly with the writings of the Urafa, they wrote in sometimes in a cryptic way because they didn't want to expose everything to the uninitiated. But at the same time, the language itself contains so many multiple meanings that that's why it's important to have a commentary and a teacher. So Haydar Amali is one thing I'm doing now. The other one is Abdurrahman Jami's short commentary on the Fusus. It's not the Fusus itself, but Ibn Arabi wrote a summary of the Fusus.
Right.
It's called Naqsh al-Fusus, the engraving of the Fusus. And so Jami was a great scholar and one of the later commentators. What he did was he collated all of the early commentaries, like Hunawis, Qaisaris, Kashanis, and then he kind of made this patchwork of commentaries in this Naqsh al-Fusus. So that one, that's been translated, and it's kind of like a simpler text and a simpler, more straightforward entryway into the Fusus al-Hikam.
Cool.
Yeah, so those are the two major projects. And of course, I have some other things that I'm working on.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
Prabhu? Do you have questions? I'll see you again, man.
I have a question. You said that all of the Quran is for nobody. It's for Muhammad Hassan. So basically, we're limited in how much we can understand the Quran.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, you also said that to know yourself is then to know Allah.
Mm-hmm.
So you need to know your limitations. So if you know your limitations and you're saying that you can't be perfect, you're saying that you can't grasp everything that you need to grasp from Islam, if I'm saying correctly. Therefore, if you know your limitations, isn't it something you can't go beyond? For example, you can't achieve attain perfection. So the individual can't then attain that level of deen understanding. So if you know you can't go that far, then are you meant to stop reach those limits then?
Okay, so a couple things. Let's go back to the first thing, that the Quran speaks about, it's an existential book. And what it means that not all of the Quran is for you, it means that your relationship to the Quran is in accordance with your munasibah, your correspondence with the verses. Muhammad has a correspondence with all of it, because it came to him, it came to his heart. It didn't come to your heart or my heart, or we're limited in relation to the Prophet. But even within the Quran, your relationship, you may actually have a verse which corresponds to you, but you don't have a correspondence to it. Let's just say, Surah Ar-Rahman, you have a correspondence with the surah. It has a correspondence with you, but you don't have a correspondence with it because you haven't developed yourself yet. So the way we employ the Quran is through an existential correspondence. It's not only a book of knowledge, but it's a book of realities. It unlocks mysteries. It unlocks things in the self. So when I didn't mean to say limitations, you don't have limitations. Allah knows your limitations. You don't know your limitations. But what you can do is you can work on yourself. Know yourself and establish correspondences with the Quran, with verses of the Quran. Yeah. So don't focus on limitations. You have limitations. You don't know what those are. All your job is to strive to attain your perfection. It is. Everyone, every human being is imperfect. Every human being. Everything other than Allah is imperfect. Only Allah is perfect. So when we say perfect, insan al-kamil, this word kamil means perfect. It also means complete. And this also has different degrees. So when we talk about the nufus, okay? So first, the animal self. Is it complete? No. You're not a complete human being if you're living as an animal. You're insan. That's why Imam Ali says, suratuhu surat al-insan. وَقَلْبُهُ قَلْبُ حَيَوَانٍ. His face, his form is like that of a human, but his heart is like that of an animal. In other words, he has not reached his humanity yet. He's living like an animal, but he looks like a human. So then you go to the next level of the nafs, nafs al-ammar, from ammara to lawama, lawama to, and so on. And the Quran mentions these different nufus. Up until it reaches nafs al-mutma'inna. Mm. And we know in the verse in the Quran, Ya ayyatuha an-nafs al-mutma'inna irji'i ila rabbiki. So now God is addressing this soul. He's saying, you, oh you, soul at peace, oh tranquil soul. In other words, oh perfect soul. So this is the first level of perfection. Now come back to your Lord. Now there's a correspondence between you and God. Before, you didn't have a correspondence between God. God's not even going to look at that soul which has no correspondence. It says in the Quran, He will not speak to them. On the Day of Judgment, God will not speak to certain individuals, right? But here, this nafs al-mutma'inna, God says, irji'i, come back to me. Come back to your Lord. Radiyatan marliya. Please, I'm pleased with you and you are pleased with me. So this is the mahal, this is where God speaks to the soul at the level of perfection. But is that nafs al mutmain, is that the absolute perfection? No, it goes further. It goes nafs al-radiya. So it's tranquil, it's perfect, but then it can reach another level of perfection. This is why sayr ilallah has an end point, but suluk does not. Okay? Because you can reach perfection. Once you reach perfection, now you are in God. First you try to reach God. Then you are in God, through God. But God has no end. The divine names have no end. You're always receiving new. كُلُّ يَوْمٍ هُوَ فِي شَأْنٍ. God, every day, every moment, He's in a new splendor. So suluk fil asma never ends. You're always in a state of majesty and beauty and ahwal and so on. So the paradise of those people is something else. It's not just milk and honey and trees and hur al-'ain and so on. It's tajalliyat, divine manifestations and so on. So even perfection has no end. This concept of perfection means it's an end, right? In the way we understand perfection. But in reality, perfection has no end. Perfection is the beginning. First you reach perfection, then you begin.
Because God is perfect, he has no end.
Exactly. And one, if you think that you will reach an end point in wujud, that you're putting a limitation on God. In your mind, you think that paradise has an end. What am I going to do there? I reach paradise, it's going to be trees and honey and milk and whatnot. What am I going to do there? I'm going to be bored. So you are placing constrictions on God, on God's creation. But God can manifest himself in infinite number of ways till eternity. And so that's why remove this idea of limitation. You have no limit. Yes, godliness. So you have no limit, but you have a qabiliyyah, you have a receptivity. Like for example, we can move on, but that's the basic idea. That you have no limit, but you have a receptivity, a certain shape in existence. But it is limitless within that shape. Yeah.
Do you have a question?
I'm just interested. Ibn Arabi was from Al-Andalus, and I know at the time he lived in what we call the Convivencia, so when different religions, the three Abrahamic religions, were all learning from each other. I heard somewhere that he had a huge influence on a school of Judaism. I don't know if you know anything about that. Or
I don't know much about that, to be honest. I don't know much about that. There's all mutual influence. The Islamic world was very fluid. He was traveling, half of his life. So he was exchanging ideas and he was receiving ideas. But remember this, fundamentally, the Arif, or Ibn al-Arabi in particular, is a visionary. He's learning from God directly. And he says that, he admits that. And he says, in most of what I write, I have received from God directly. This is what is known as ilm al-ladunni. Direct knowledge. That's why he's an arif, not a philosopher. Yeah.
Do you want to say that one?
Yeah, interesting. You mentioned the point, because we talked about those influenced by Ibn Arabi. But in terms of his influences, you talked about direct knowledge from God. But there are those who might be skeptical,
mm-hmm.
might say, we all carry baggage, you must have some previous learning. Muslim philosophy, for example, there have been Greek influence, Aristotle, etc. Who has been identified previously from older traditions as being a heavy influence on Ibn Arabi?
That's a good question. There's obvious themes, Neoplatonic themes in Ibn Arabi's thought, Ishraq and this idea of faith. Platonus talked about it, Aristotle talked about it, Plato talked about it, all the Greeks talked about these ideas. So it's not something which is completely discrete and in a vacuum. Of course, he studied in Seville. He studied the traditional sciences. He was a scholar of Islam. He knew fiqh and usul and Quran and hadith, and he was familiar with all of this. So it's not that he was sitting in a vacuum just receiving knowledge. Whereas the Prophet, peace be upon him, was more or less in a vacuum. Arabia was kind of a vacuum, but at the same time, the Prophet was also colored by his environment. There was knowledge at the time. He wasn't ignorant of all things. He didn't live on an island. So he also spoke the language, and revelation came in the language of the people of the time. That's important. So when Muslims tend to discard pre-Islamic, jahiliyyah, knowledge and poetry and so on, but that's somewhat erroneous, that there has to be there's a context in which revelation came to the Prophet. Similarly, there's a context in which, to what extent, who knows, I don't know, that's another subject. To what extent did he borrow, to what extent did it influence him, or did it just simply corroborate what he saw in visions? And Sadr ibn Qunawi writes, I think I've quoted this in the book, that the ancient Greeks, Socrates was a hakim, Plato was an arif, Aristotle, they were orafa. They were not just philosophers as we know them We've labeled them as philosophers, that they just thought about things with their rational mind and they didn't have inspiration. There's no way that Aristotle could have come up with all of that knowledge and learning just by his own brain power. I mean, his material to this day is studied. One man, and he completely revolutionized all human learning. There's no way he could have come up with that by himself without inspiration. And all knowledge is ultimately from God. And Socrates also admits to that kind of thing.
Okay.
Yeah.
So there's loads of things you brought up, and I want to have it recorded as well. Just some of these things. I need to try and organize all my thoughts, because what's going to happen, I'm going to finish this and then I'm going to regret it. Because there's a lot of things I had prepared to sort of discuss with you. Okay, some of the things I want to sort of cover is Ibn Arabi and Neoplatonism. Ibn Arabi and the Hanbali school, because you brought up Manazil al-Sa'ilin, okay, and that's something I'm really interested in. The other thing is, because you mentioned as we were talking that some of these stuff here, for a lot of Muslims, those who are brought up in the UK, is alien, right?
Mm-hmm.
But what is interesting is that this was all mainstream amongst the Ottomans and amongst the quite interesting how he sort of bridges both Sunni and Shia in a way that very few people can or have, right? And you have all these, like I think you mentioned, that there's hundreds of commentaries on him, okay? I have my own sort of reasons, or I have my own thoughts about the reasons for why there was that. I think it's because of a certain movement in the 18th century and it sort of consequences on the rest of the Sunni world by all of this stuff. It seems so new to us when in fact it was just so normal. So that's another thing I want to cover. Things about contention, obviously the things you've said today, nature of the language, one of our audience members sort of inquired about when you said filla, what exactly did you mean that? And that's something that always plagues Ibn Arabi in terms of how you receive these words. Those are some of the topics I want to cover. I hope you don't mind. I hope that's not just too big.
No, it's good.
Too big, and I hope we've got enough time to sort of cover this, or at least you can signpost us. Or
sure,
where
sure.
To go. So let's talk about Ibn Arabi and Neoplatonicism. I think like for a lot of people, when we look at like so Neoplatonicism sort of influences sort of like Ismaili thought a lot, right?
Yeah.
And there is something quite compelling about it, but at the same time, there's something which is very difficult to accept about it, because it sounds like I said, I'm not coming as an expert, I'm just coming as a sort of ordinary person who sort of sees these things sort of passing by, right? It comes across as a kind of like atheism through fancy language, right? Because then you have God who's just so ineffable, right? You can't say anything about him, positive, negative. And then you have this demiurge figure who's not whom we actually worship. And then when you read, especially near the last chapter, like we talk about the Loh and the Qalam and the angels and stuff, it sort of maps on nicely to this sort of Neoplatonic kind of hierarchy. And at the same time, Ibn Arabi is mainstream, like sort of part of mainstream Sunni thought up until sort of very recently because of certain geopolitical reasons, right? Mm. What's the relationship between Ibn Arabi and Neoplatonism, first of all, and how do we make sense of that sort of being within sort of like at least sort of a Sunni sort of perspective? Like how does that square up?
Okay, this is a good question. When we talk about the arif, sahib al-haqiqa, the person of reality, he doesn't care about Sunnism or Shiism.
Right.
He doesn't care about Hanbalism or which school of thought. Why? Or he doesn't care about Platonism or any other ism. Why? Because he's after reality.
Right. These are like human conventions that
we exactly,
use.
Right?
Sure.
So for the arif, for the sahib al-haqiqa, all those isms and human conventions get thrown out the window. Now, you can look at it from a historical perspective and superimpose some of these ideas. Yeah, we can say, oh, you know, Shias want to claim Ibn Arabi because he talks about wilaya, and he talks about imama and this and that. All these different things he talks about, And the Sunnis are like, no, come on, that's ridiculous. He wasn't a Shia, okay? Even though you want to appropriate all the, you know, this adif and that adif and say everybody was a Shia. No. So yeah, so you can maybe look at it from a historical or meta-historical perspective, but the essence of it is that the adif doesn't care about that. He doesn't care. Even the hukum shar'i, even when he wants to know what is haram and halal, he looks at reality. He looks at what is, maybe there some convention that he doesn't know the hukum in wujud, the real hukum in existence. He doesn't know, so from convention he follows some madhab. If you don't know something, then you just follow what you know, the madhab that you know, what you're brought up with, and so on. But the actual fact is that the arif operates through haqiqa. In the same way that if there was poison in this water, it would kill you, it would kill me. It doesn't care whether it's your Sunni or Shia or this madhab or that madhab or what's your ethnicity and identity. It makes no difference. So this is how the arif operates. He's operating with realities, with things. If he sees food and he sees that this food has something wrong with it from basira, he's looking at it from basira, he won't eat it, even though it's halal for him. His friend made it, but he says, no, you know what? There's something wrong with this food. I don't have a munasaba to this food. He's seeing the signs, the divine signs, so he's operating like that. He's operating with realities, with things. He says, this water, it may be halal, but there's something I see in this water that doesn't have a correspondence with me. So that's how it works. He's operating with realities. Most of the time, not all the time.
Okay.
So that's just a general way to answer your question. Otherwise, we can say, yeah, you know, there's a lot of Neoplatonic themes in Ibn al-Arabi. There's a lot of, and he knows these thinkers.
I think the problem is, Dr. Ali, is that there comes a point where it's so subtle that just people can't, like, it's just too difficult to start grasping, you know what I'm saying? And so I guess this comes to this brings me to my next point regarding his sort of like critics. Before I get there, I just want to make sure, I just want to be satisfied that I've got what I want to hear about Ibn Arabi and Neoplatonism. Okay, fine. So you're saying these are just like, we should overlook the conventions, we should sort of realize that they're operating at a certain other kind of almost sort of subtle quantum level, and we shouldn't get distracted by.
It's simple. It's simpler than that. For the person of reality,
right?
I don't mean arif. Anybody. You're concerned with reality, are you not? Yes, you are.
Yes.
Okay, that's what we're here, right? If there was a medicine that benefited you, you say you were sick one day. Would you care if it came from this country or that country? No, you don't care.
Right.
You just you would take whatever benefits you.
Right.
So the arif looks at wujud, all of existence, as his pharmacy or her pharmacy.
Wisdom is the lost baggage of the
community. Exactly, right. Exactly. So for them, they're operating through existence existentially, meaning like they look at things for what they truly are. So the Prophet said, "Arin al ashya kama hiya." Oh God, show me things as they truly are. Show me the reality of things.
Mm-hmm.
The world is a big pharmacy. So it doesn't make a difference whether the Sunni made it or the Shia made the medicine. If you're sick, you're going to take that medicine.
I'm still understanding why some scholars of this traditional, so Muslim scholars, sort of didn't like talking about this in a big platform because it gets... can get quite overwhelming, but I think it's important to understand because I think it's a lost legacy, and also because in this day and age, I don't think we can play this game of the sort of unwashed awam. We're going to keep things away from them because that's not how information works anymore, and people are going to come across it. So right. It's best that you give a good presentation of it so that. When inevitably they're going to come across the ideas, at least they have a good presentation to sort of. Give some kind of lucid, coherent sense of it. Otherwise, they may misinterpret it, or they may get sort of a jaundiced sort of perspective on it.
Right.
Okay, let's come to Ibn Arabi and his critics, right? So, like, there's people watching this, and there's the statements you've made all the way through, right? Which, like, if you don't like, if you're not inclined to him, you can easily grasp on any of these things, right? When he says, you know, you find fillah billah and all that kind of lillah and all that kind of stuff, and say, look, you're just promoting pantheism and all that kind of, and that's an obvious one that he's accused of, and the wahdat al-wujud and his pantheism and all that kind of stuff. How, because you've given us lots of general things to think about rather than sort of giving a very specific answer. Ibn Arabi and his critics, how would you sort of respond to these accusations of pantheism and this kind of stuff the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam never taught, and all the usual sort of contentions that you're aware of? How would you sort of respond to some people watching this who are sort of very sort of skeptical about all of this?
Right.
With all their different backgrounds.
Right. See, the thing is that we go back to this idea that Ibn al-Arabi, the Arif, first of all, Ibn al-Arabi is an Arif. Or Hakim. And these people, the Urafa, the Hukama, are trying to investigate how the world works. That's what the philosopher is doing. The philosopher is trying to explain the world, trying to dissect it, investigate how it operates. So they don't care about isms and so on. So that's one thing. I just want to like reiterate that.
Yeah.
That these people are people of reality. Mm-hmm. They're dealing with realities. Same thing with, like, you know, your cell phone or your car. You don't care if an atheist made it. Mm. Oh, you just want it to work. You don't care if you go to the hospital and the guy, the surgeon who's operating on you is a mushrik, kafir, zindiq, whatever you want to call him. You don't care. You just want to be cured. So that's the attitude you have to have when you look into this material. If you look into, you're looking for isms, you want to put them in a box, then it's a slippery slope because they say contradictory things. Mm-hmm. But if you say, okay, what is the, and so that's why you need a framework of understanding how wujud works. How does God operate? God doesn't have a single law. He has layers. And his sunnah is change. He loves to change things around. It's why he sent hundreds of thousands of prophets, and each time he gave a new law. He could have just stuck to one law. He could have stuck to one race, one nation. But God loves change. So he wants to change the whole fabric of existence in front of you. One day he says, this is haram, the next day he says, it's halal, and vice versa. For one nation it's this, another nation it's that. So to read this material, you have to also understand the sunnah of Allah. How does Allah speak to the awliya? So when Ibn al-Arabi is receiving this material, one day he's in this hal, another day he's in another hal. And this is also why you find, even in the hadith, you find contradictory statements. You find in the Quran contradictory statements. They're not contradictions in reality. They appear to us as contradictions.
Right.
So, for example, Allah laysa kamithlihi shay'. There's nothing like Allah. There's nothing like Him. But at the same time, huwa Allah, huwa ilahun fis sama, wa huwa ilahun fil ard. He's the same God that's in the heavens as He's on the earth. Mm. How do you explain that verse? Mm. Oh, ar-Rahman ala al-arshi istawa. Mm. Ar-Rahman, He sat upon the throne. He not sat, but istawa. Reposed upon the throne. Mm-hmm. How do you make sense out of these anthropomorphic verses in the Quran? I'm not speaking about Ibn al-Arabi. We're talking about the Quran itself. So we have these type of contradictory statements. So we have to get out of our way of thinking, our standard theology, the theology that has been inherited to us by, you know, the Shia school or the you know, Akhbari or the
Yeah, the Ash'ari,
Mu'tazila, and so on.
Yeah.
Okay? think out of the box. They had their way, they had their way of thinking, they contradicted each other, they had polemics and so on. Let's get on with it. The same thing with Islamic law. You try to implement Islamic law as the Prophet implemented in his time, you don't understand the law.
Right.
So there has to be a dynamism, and this is a sunnah of Allah, that he changes with time. Now, do the principles change? No. The principle is sound. Ethics, justice, humanity, aql, intelligence, mercy, compassion. These are that's why it goes back to the divine names, because those symbolize the foundation of existence. So, wahdat al-wujud. It's simple. It's nothing complicated. Allah is one. He cannot be two. It's only one God. And we have multiplicity of existence. So, that same God is everywhere. As Imam Ali alayhi salam said, look at the statement. He said this multiple times in Nahj al-Balagha. He says, "Dakhilun fil ashya." God is in all things. Dakhil. He's in all things. Laysa bil mumazaja. Mazj. He's not like intermixed with them, but he's in them. Kharijun anil ashya. He's outside of all things. Laysa bil muzayala. But he's not isolated. He's not. So how do you? Imam Ali is making contradictions.
I think the nature of you have contradiction and you have paradox, and paradox is just trying to express realities that are so profound that
exactly
they don't seem to align in that. We've only got 5 minutes.
You have other questions? We can go into that. Otherwise, the issue of wahdat al-wujud is...
Wahdat al-wujud is quite straightforward. If someone reads straightforward account, wahdat al-wujud, they're really all... Because it's about God is real, everything else is contingent, and therefore they only exist by the will of God. I mean, that I think is quite... it's up to people. Like, the things you say, which, because of the nature of words... if you don't like someone, you're going to take those words and you say, hey, this guy's a pantheist, right? So, I mean, you can't win against people who are drawn just against you and are not going to give you a chance.
Right.
I've got 5 minutes. I want to talk about Ibn Arabi and the Hanbali tradition. How am I going to do this in 5 minutes?
Other questions, maybe? Criticisms and whatnot?
Yeah, I thought we'd just wrap up with a few questions of your own.
What happened to al-wujud on this topic, as you said, it's pretty straightforward.
Yeah.
There can only be one thing, which is wujud.
Right.
Wujud is a single concept.
Right.
You cannot have two wujuds.
Right.
It doesn't make any sense. So there's only one thing, which is wujud. Now, that wujud, is it identical to Allah or not? This is the question.
Right.
Okay, there can only be one thing. There's only one God and only one wujud. Now, we have this issue. Whether or not that one thing is identical to the one Allah, one being, that we say Allah. This is where the paradox lies. And this is why Imam Ali answered that question. He says he's in things, but he's not in them. Mm-hmm. So the that of Allah, the essence of Allah, is the unknowable essence. Mm-hmm. And this is why this ontology is so important to understand life, understand the deen, mm-hmm. understand the Quran. Because he's not talking about some random philosophy. He's looking into the world. He's looking into the Quran. He's looking into the hadith. And he's trying to explain it to you. He's saying, look, it's only one thing. The only way to explain it is by saying that God, dhatan, his essence is unknowable, it's absolute. Mm-hmm. But that absolute essence has degrees of manifestation. God reveals himself, he unfolds himself, he manifests himself, discloses himself. Mm. Whatever word you want to use, it's the same being who manifests himself in wujud. But can you say that this is God? No. You can say this is the mazhar of Allah. This is the ayat of Allah. This is the sign of God. This is a manifestation of God. But is it God himself? No, it's not. That's why it's just not pantheism. Because pantheism is saying everything is God. No, This is the sign of God. And this is why we disagree with the Christians when they say that Jesus is God. No, he is the manifestation of God, the complete manifestation, the mirror of God. And there's a section on mirror of God. Mm. All the Urufa talk about the mirror of God.
The other thing I'm personally quite interested in is Sufism in the Hanbali tradition. Because for a lot of people, that sounds sort of counterintuitive, right? And that's because of sort of things that's happened since the 18th century, right? To put it as a euphemism, right? But you've looked at Manazil As-Sa'ilin. Now, one thing that the Hanbali approach to the divine attributes is to say that we don't know what they mean, right? Tafwid al-Ma'na, right?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
And you know, like how you're saying that we should always sort of see things in the bigger intellectual cultural context. I always wondered whether, because when you say, oh, we don't know what that means, Ar-Rahman al-Arsh istawa, or what, we don't know what that means. And they say, well, why does God reveal that? But sometimes I think because love comes first, then comes words, right? And there is a rich Hanbali Sufi tradition, like of Manazil As-Sa'ilin,
yeah,
and others, right?
Yeah.
And also, I think what also is counterintuitive is how, like, many of the sort of the later Ottoman Hanbali figures have taken Ibn Arabi and sort of like made that as part of, sort of squared that up with their tradition as well, right? Again, which sounds counterintuitive. So in the remaining, like, whatever 2 minutes we have, please help. What would be sort of your thoughts on the idea of Tafwid al-Ma'na, Mahabba, and the cosmology of Ibn Arabi?
Okay. So the way that Ibn al-Arabi explains that a person reaches perfection is by embodying the divine names. This
right.
is what it means to be human.
Right.
So if you are compassionate, then you are embodying the divine name Ar-Rahman.
Right.
And that is the hallmark of your humanity, is to reveal, to manifest the divine name inside of you.
Right.
Which is closer to godliness, knowledge or ignorance? Knowledge, because it's a divine name. So when you embody it by studying and learning, you embody the divine name Al-Aleem. When you become wise through knowledge and so on, you become Al-Hakim. So you are embodying these divine qualities. Okay? So it's not that we cannot know them. We don't know their absolute entirety because they belong to God fundamentally. But God has deposited, has created us, this fitrah that he says, fitrat Allah allati fatana nas alayha. Fitrat Allah. What is this divine fitrah? Fitrah is human nature. What is this human nature which made the angels prostrate before Adam? It means the divine names. The ruh is the divine names. So, in short, you can know them. And you must know them. And to become truly human, it is to embody the divine names. And this is the whole crux and the essence of Ibn al-Arabi's thought. And this comes from the hadith, تَخَلَّقُوا بِأَخْلَاقِ اللَّهِ, from the Prophet, peace be upon him. تَخَلَّقُوا بِأَخْلَاقِ اللَّهِ. أَخْلَاقِ اللَّهِ means أَسْمَاءُ اللَّهِ. So that's the path, that's the way.
Let's wrap it up.
Yeah.
Okay. We could go on for another couple of hours. I just don't think, like for loads of Muslims brought up in this country, right? You know, owing to certain international geopolitical economic reasons, right? There's a certain sort of brand of Islam which sort of characterizes urban Islam in the UK or the Anglosphere in general, right? And part of that is just utter oblivion to the Akbarian school, despite being so mainstream amongst Sunnis and Shias, right? But anyway, this is probably the most lucid account as an introduction, and I do encourage you to look at this. And I hope we can continue this conversation again. Thanks so very much, Dr. Ali.
My pleasure. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you. And thank you to our viewers. And inshallah, we'll do more of these in the future.
Inshallah.